I've been focusing with my classes that have been people, you have people, a lot of you have been teaching a long time, and you have people in your class forever, and you have to keep coming up with things. And now, thank God, we have YouTube and Ceramic Arts Daily and all these things to keep us with a feed of information. A lot of you are probably going to know as much about this as I do, maybe more. If you have comments, just I'll be happy to have you add something in. I have very poor examples of this because this is just all I had right now. But this is a slip stencil design underneath a glaze, fired in the reduction kiln. And it was just a demo pot that I did. This is also stenciled slip put on a, and this is in cone temp reduction, so yes, you can get pink. So there's that. And then this is something else. I'll tell you what that is after. Okay. So one of the things that intrigued me, this was a workshop I took with, can't remember, I think Sean O'Connell or somebody, but this is not fired. So if you handle this, it's greenware. Be careful. And the thing that got to me about this is I like slip trailing. I started out glaze trailing more than slip trailing to make the brims of bowls and things more interesting. So this is slip applied. I'll show you this technique. Using different colors of slip and layering, and then using the color of the bare clay. I made these pots in the stoneware so that it was easier for you to see the contrast and things. The first thing that you can do with stencils that's kind of easy, if you have a flat surface. Okay, so I have this tile. Let me move this. So I have a tile. Stencils are all over the place. If you don't have your own stencil cutter, which one of my students fortunately just bought, and I have a whole bunch of things for him to do, and you can resize things, it's handy to have, but there's a lot of these. Say what you will about Martha Stewart, she makes a nice quality stencil. She does.
Do you know if it's okay to sell something that Martha Stewart stencils?
Well, she puts it out there, and she doesn't say if, I mean, if you put it on furniture, but if you put it on furniture, you know.
But it's usually for somebody to use in their own home rather than selling.
Right, but if you, some people decorate furniture and sell it. And
yeah.
I think if you've bought it, she's been paid, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think so, too. And I think, and a lot of these, the same thing with these stencils. I mean, people are putting it on things that they're selling. So this is fun. This is a, where's my roll? All right, so this is, basically I use two kinds of slip. This is a slip that's a formula, formula meaning it has a flux in it, has different kinds of clay, different stuff. I didn't make this one myself. It's a slip that can actually be used on bisque also. If you look up slip recipes, you can find them. Generally, if you're going to use slip on a bisque piece, it has to be thin, unless it's a really vitreous, melty slip. It has to be thin. Otherwise, what will happen is it doesn't bond the same way to bisque as it will to the greenware and get fired on. So what will happen is sometimes you'll see on this where even on the, if it's too thick, even on this one, there's places where it'll start to want to, the slip will want to come off and take the glaze off with it. So, but you can find a lot of great slip recipes. So this is just a tile to show you one thing. I'm using the brush to kind of make some kind of streaky background. I'm purposely not wanting this to be this is greenware, yes, greenware. And then stencils do seem to have two different sides. One side is flatter than the other side. Now, the nice thing about this, it's going to stick right to it. You don't have to At this point, we don't need a silk screen because this is going to stick. And then... Yeah, if I had let it, all right, we're going to have to, you know, this is not like the cooking channel. I didn't. that's what somebody said to me when I, do you have one in the oven? Do you have one in the oven?
They're called swap outs.
Swap outs, right. If I let it dry a little longer, we'll see what happens. I mean, it probably, it may pull. Okay, so, and I'm just going to take this roller. Just roll in here. Okay. And then just lift it off.
That's a color
a green slip.
Yeah. Yes. Now there's not this is not as much contrast on here as I thought there was on the green, but okay. But wait, there's more. So now one of the things that I find is I like to take something that's very literal looking like this, or airbrushing, and try to do something else with it. So what you can do is go around, like freehand, go around the design. This is a little more complicated than you might want to use, but something where you're following the line,
what
or some of the lines. This is
it's a molding tool.
Thank you. No. Right.
What is it? I didn't hear what you said.
It's a rubber-tipped molding tool.
Sculpting tool.
Yeah. Sculpting. Okay. So I'm just going to go around some of this so that you can get the idea looking at this. And then you can carve through. I wish there was more contrast on this one. Now, this would have been a little bit better if I let it dry a little bit longer, but the problem is if I had primed it with the slip and then put the other slip on, then it would have been too dry to, you know what I mean? So it can look a little way around with something that really takes clay off. Again, the idea being to kind of highlight part of it. That's one thing. Then this is a little tricky to get to come out right. But you have to fool around with it. It depends a lot on the thickness of your slip. So the first time I did this, I got confused with what goes where. You'll see what I'm talking about. Okay. I'm going to take this off so we can use this side. All right. Your stencil goes on the back of the silk screen. Not as easy to remember for me as I think. So I'm going to tape this down.
What mesh is that screen?
It's the fine one. They're just, I don't know exactly the mesh because it wasn't labeled, but there were, this I got at A.I. Friedman, and if you can't see through it at all, like if it looks like really, 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 that's the one you want. It comes just about, it only came two ways.
And you know how you said there were two different sides of the stencil? Does it matter which goes flat against the silk?
I don't know. It seems like there's a more cut-looking side, which I tend to put, in this case, it'll be facing me. I didn't really pay too much attention on the silk screen. On the other one, it seemed to matter more. And this is a little bouncy, so it's a little annoying. But... Now, just for housekeeping purposes, it's a good idea to put tape in the silk screen just so that it doesn't get all in the corners and you get slip in there and then you can't get the slip out. Because I don't have black slip in there. And it does get under there. This is the exciting part.
Well, this, you know, you know, there's always saying, gee, I bought rice paper, and I thought, oh, gee, I'll buy really nice paper. It doesn't work. It has to be newsprint or even thinner than newsprint. So, like the wrapping, this is the paper that we wrap pots in, the cheap paper. Mm-hmm. And then this is a newsprint pad. Mm-hmm. So, and you need a single sheet. Need a single sheet. Like that. The interesting thing about this is that you can do these. I'm going to do more than one cup. If you don't try to move it around too much, you can dry it, leave it dry on the paper, and then spray it and use it. It's kind of an interesting, bring it back to life kind of a thing. So your consistency is like, what would you say, soft pudding? Mm-hmm. Somebody once said to me, like pancake batter, and I thought, well, that depends on the pancake batter. All pancake batter's not the same. And you don't need a lot. I'm gonna slip. I could actually run a piece of tape on here so I don't. All right, and then, in there. And then pick it up.
Nice.
Okay. Mm-hmm. What happened to the end there? So, that just has to dry a tiny bit. Stencil thicknesses, you'll notice, that's a particularly thin one. These, which are not as sophisticated, if you don't have a silk screen and you want to use it for students or it's like great for kids, is you could just put this right down on the paper and silk screen right through it. That's what I did with this. I just took a piece of paper. I have to do a bunch of these. And held this down. I think it wants to go that way. And this you could do with a red rib. I made a mess because I forgot I had my red rib to use instead of this, but so like that. And then, but it's this thickness, so there's a lot of those on Amazon.
Georgia, can you move the little pot, the white pot?
So what else can you do to make it a little more interesting and a little more personalized? Magic part of shaking. Okay,
Famous last words.
That's how it goes, right? And then the pot, I just make sure the pot isn't, I mean, I kept these dry a while, so. But you could just kind of dampen that just to make sure. Doesn't everybody love this thing?
Mm-hmm.
Yet another use for it. Okay, so. Oh, hello. I'm going to spray the back. Yeah, Mom, I got a tattoo.
Church, did you do the front or the back on that?
The back.
The back, okay.
The back.
If you do the front, the...
So it soaks through.
Slipples.
Slipper slide.
Okay. Now, also you have to remember that I'm not being totally fussy that this comes out perfectly because I actually don't want it to. You know what I mean? I'll show you what I'm going to do to it after. So I'm going to take a damp sponge first.
Fine excuse.
Absolutely. Who was that?
I wanted it to be perfect.
I really wasn't trying. That's just what I was trying to do. I didn't. So I'm just going, pressing in with
this. That's what I tell customers.
Oh, this is special. It's one of a kind because I hope this never happens again. Oh, my God. Did you ever go to a show that honestly sell your pots and you have something you're almost embarrassed to put out, but you're running a little short, so you put this pot out, you don't really like it, and somebody says, oh, my God, this is so beautiful. Somebody said that to me once. I didn't sell a single thing that I really, my favorite things, I didn't even sell them. Okay, so I'm trying to make sure the slip gods are with me, that this is all on there.
Would you like a drum?
Oh,
Mom.
Wow. Oh, aren't you kind? You're also kind. You're very kind. You're very kind.
Do you ever have trouble with the paper sticking?
No. What I have trouble with, actually the trouble, as you can see here, is that the stencil, the paper puckers. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know why it's puckering with the blue, and I don't know if it's there's mason stain in there. I don't know if that gives the slip a different, I mean, that's my only problem. If you want this to be better, you know, like if you wanted to fill it in, just say you wanted to do that, you could do that. And again, I should have let it dry just a tiny bit longer, but then you can't do this. Okay, this is the fun too.
Do you make all these slips yourself?
Yeah, this is, as I started to say, two kinds of slip. One slip is the formulated slip that we just happen to use in the studio where I work. But the other slip that I will show you, I use a porcelain slip. I really hate reclaiming my clay, and I use porcelain almost all the time. So what I started to do is take all my trimmings and turn it into marshmallow slip. Marshmallow is just the thickness of, like, marshmallow fluff would be. And I don't add anything to it. People add soda ash, or they add this, or they add that, and I don't. Matt Long came years and years ago, and he said, all you do is, you know, so what you do is you take your trimmings, and you can't have a big chunk in with your trimmings. You want trimmings or bash down your clay. And you put it in a bucket. You cover it to the top with hot water. Don't try to rush it. If you have to, you know, it's not as good. Leave it overnight, take the bucket, pour the standing water off the top, so, and then take your Jiffy mixer, paint mixer, whatever you use, and beat the crap out of it. Just keep going and beating it and beating it and beating it until it's all fluffy and smooth. Mm-hmm. And then, if you're really like a little crazy, you can sieve it, which I do because I use it to slather on pots on a leather hard pot on the wheel. You know, it's just, it's so much fun. And the thing is, if you don't put it through the sieve, the one little chunk that escapes will turn out right where it shouldn't be, you know. And I use a lot of celadons, and that will, the little show it up. So
have you ever put it in a blender? The slip works really well.
Yeah, but I'm usually doing a lot more than, or I've used, and I use the hand blender actually to make this, because I had to make an emergency batch. Okay, so this is pretty much on here. So what I'm going to do, ask me.
Okay, to then color the porcelain slip, you use mason stains?
Yes. You can use the porcelain slip, or you can use a formulated slip. You can do this with a porcelain slip. Okay, so I'm going to go with a thin line.
Is that the consistency right now, the marshmallow consistency, the slip that you're spraying
on?
No,
that I will show you on something else. That's act two. Okay, so this is, I just made this black because I wanted to have some contrast of what I'm doing, just to show you. So I'm taking this and I'm going over, so that really I've almost just made something for me, myself, to follow.
I turn the other way too.
Yeah, I will.
The other folks.
When I have something to show.
So the consistency of the slip that you put in the trailer, I've never been able to.
This is
that
this
right.
isn't on because it's on greenware. I'm okay with any thickness of slip. It's. You
don't want it to glob out of the
trailer.
Oh,
this is the Zyme slip trailer. Oh, it's really nice. Okay. So that...
X-I-E-M.
And it's Bailey. And, you know, it's funny because I was at Ceramic Supply, and you know the bat mats that you can put underneath those fabric things? Well, Zyme makes a great one. And I was at Ceramic Supply one Saturday sale thing, and I said, do you have any of those? And they said, no, we have to get some. I said, you don't have it because you don't carry anything from the company that makes them, you know, and I don't know why. I should call Jim and say, like, what's up with that? But, no, I know him. He owes me. He's made mistakes. Just, these things, by the way, get the little pins. I have three kinds of slip trailers here. The first one, the best, from Sally's Beauty Supply, and get the Clairol one, or they have another one, they make their own brand, wait for a sale, they're like less than $2 each, and the tip, as you can see, I cut one of them, you can, it's got a very fine tip, and then it goes all the way down to,
and it's called Betty's?
Sally's Beauty Supply.
Oh, okay.
The drugstores used to have them, but they don't anymore, so you know, so now you can go and, you know, you can do whatever you want with, you know, you could go over and...
I noticed that you close up the slip nozzles with, what do you plug in to them?
That's so a pin don't... that comes with it. It comes with these. And let me tell you, if you don't clean them out and they rust shut, forget about it. You know, they're not stainless or, you know, this one is stainless, but... There's also a really expensive one that looks just like this. It's like $50, and I bought it. It got stolen. But it's very expensive, and it was guaranteed not to, you know, not to clog and everything. It's made in Germany at Ceramic Supply. It's like, and I had it. But then once that went away, I figured I'm not doing that again. So I got, this is Zyme one. And it comes in a couple of different sizes, and it comes with a couple of different tips. So this is... basically one of the fun things to do with that. Okay. And then again on here, you could do more with the carving through. The other thing too with the layering, you know, having fun where I'm not gonna be anal on this. It's just gonna be very hard.
We feel your pain.
Somebody told me I'm so disorganized.
That's good.
And somebody said to me once, you know, a woman I really respected until she said this, she said, did it ever occur to you that you're a perfectionist? And I thought, me? Hardly, you know. But anyway, evidently I can be crazy. Okay, so now you can see this one started to dry.
Okay.
using the same pattern, just because this pattern lends itself to... Now this time I will spray the front and the back because it sat there.
Okay. It's dry.
It's too dry. It got dry now. So I'm going to let that sit. Now, if anybody over here didn't see this, this is basically... I tried. I'm gonna confess something, and it'll probably make some people feel a lot better about themselves hearing this. I was ready to do this last week. I mixed the dates up, and I didn't even remember it was Valentine's Day or anything. I completely mixed the dates up, and then so these pots were kept wet, and then they got dry, and then they got wet, and then they got dry. So that's what happened.
And here you are.
So I was ready way too early. Now again. Now with this, I'm gonna carve more through. This I let get blurrier. Now the other thing too, now on this one you can see, since I blurred it out, I actually just sort of made something to follow. So that now, on this one, I've, the actual stencil isn't even, you know, anything, it doesn't even resemble the stencil. It's white, yeah, it's just that. That's just a white slip.
But that's going to stay on the fire.
It's kind of blobbed out on me.
Three colors, basically.
Yeah, you can keep going with the colors, you know?
Georgia, can I ask why, did you carve a hole where you're going to put the slip? Or was that just extra?
What?
You just right now, when you carve those holes in there, is that where you're putting? Why did you do that instead of just putting a slip on it?
What do you mean? I'm sorry. I don't...
Circles. The circles that you just carved.
Oh, I just did them. I was going to see if this went in the inside, which it didn't do. You know what I mean? Like I thought it was going to go more on the.
Oh, I see. So you wanted the contrast between the line and the... Oh, I see.
Okay, so you could get. Okay, before you go, I have one more trick. If somebody has to go, but this is like, I have something. I take the porcelain, and then you take the dry porcelain, and then I draw ginkgo leaves on it, and then you brush shellac on that. If anyone doesn't know the technique, and then you let it dry forever, and then you take a wet sponge and you wash away, and the shellacked area stays raised. And then, of course, to make it more complicated, I thought, gee, these ginkgo leaves would look much better if they had little veins in them. So I was, you know, scratching little veins in the dry clay, and then I thought, you know, clay shouldn't really be dry when you do that. So then I moved it to where the pot is leather hard, and I'm drawing the leaves and carving little veins through. This is very time consuming. And if you're making something, Jennifer and I, we had this discussion the other day. If you're making a vase, you can sell it for more and it's worth more work. But on a cup, you know, you start going through these practical considerations. So I thought about the marshmallow slip. So this, and I'll pass it around, this is done a different way. I thought, what can I do to get that effect, but faster? So the answer was the marshmallow slip, which is here's the one that's thick. Okay. So this is marshmallow slip. The marshmallow slip, if you want to use it in throwing, if you were going to use marshmallow slip throwing, picture this on the wheel. It's leather hard. I've trimmed the bottom. And so now I would take
some marshmallow. I would, you know, get it stuck down. I would take marshmallow slip, which consists of just dipping your hands like in the pudding consistency slip, getting the wheel going, and then smearing it on the outside, and then waving your fingers or a rib or something around it. It holds its form. It doesn't flatten out. It stays in the bisque, just what you did to it, with nothing in it. So that's how you use it for that. Now for this, we're going to do, make sure this isn't too dry. So then what else could I do to get these ginkgo leaves in a much easier form? So what I'm going to do is draw the leaf. So I've outlined it. I'm going to take a paintbrush and pull the slip in.
And the camera, too.
All right, hold on. One second. Let me just fix it up a little.
It looks beautiful.
It's not ready for Hollywood here. So that's what that comes out like. Hmm. And it's a whole lot faster.
Wow.
It's in one shot. It you know, it just stays, and it'll stay just like that. Now, the only example of this, that's what this is on here. You can pass that around. And then it's on here. And what I did is I took the white slip and just put clear glaze. The clear glaze was very thick. So it's like an optical, you can hardly see what's under there. But that's basically what it comes out like. So again, and then, you know, if you Google, Google is such a wonderful thing. If you Google ginkgo leaves or any pattern like that, so many things come up. You know, it's such a wonderful source for.
Is that a brush you're using?
Yes.
To scrape away?
Yeah, I'm pulling it with a brush. By the way, did you know that you can look up where all the ginkgo trees in New York City are?
They are so smelly.
Well, only if you get the female.
The female, the males are
yeah.
not.
And Ramsey, in its infinite wisdom, Ramsey planted a whole row of them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I could do it with that. Depending on, you know, how you, like, the fun thing is to leave a thick edge on it. It, like, kind of, and again, that will stay just like that. It's really, really amazing.
Technically, you call that reverse carbon.
Yeah, I mean, really, it's just like.
And you could use multiple colors.
This is, we have time, do we have time? Let's see, what did I leave out? I didn't even look at my notes, okay. Oh, I'm going to show you something else that's really pretty. The background color, okay, so the background color, you could brush on a color first,
okay. And
then do it over that. You can also, you know, you can do this with underglaze. I mean, too.
The underglaze might come up your screen now more, right?
I don't know. You know,
if you could paint the underglaze on there.
So far, we've only underglazed with the stencils, holding them directly on pots because. The student that was doing this was making really big things, and he was just using parts of, you know, so, you know, like small stencils and doing, because that's the other thing, too, is you don't have to use this exactly the way it is, you know.
With your porcelain slip, do you find that you can put a porcelain slip on top of any other clay and it will stay?
Yeah, you can.
Okay.
Yeah. If it's the same temperature, even the porcelain to the brown clay, because this is our studio, this is 306, Cone 10,
And the white, the porcelain is Helios. It's fine.
And so, I've used it on earthenware, porcelain slip on earthenware.
Yeah, you can. It's really amazing.
Test.
Yeah, test it. I would test it on earthenware just to make sure. Well, see, I have like something worse than cone 10. Cone 10 is such a wicked, and the gas kiln is such a wicked way to fire, you know. It's like so hard on everything. So if it works there. Okay, this is scissors. Here, okay. All right, so this, unfortunately, this slip, I didn't put enough slip through here, but we'll fake it. I'll show you anyway. I don't care if this is blurry either, this one. And I'm not just saying that. I know it's funny. The students love when you make a mistake. They feel so much better to know that it could happen to you, right? Okay. Why don't you try to do it in front of me? Well, I'm trying to do it in front of me so you can see, but you're just going to get the idea. Just for the. You know, I took, over the years, I've taken like every workshop there ever was. and one of them many years ago was in silk streaming. I mean, that's airbrushing. And it looked just like airbrushing, you know, like the t-shirts. And it was that probably in the 70s anyway. And it was just. And I put that whole airbrush thing away because I just didn't want to, you know, I don't like that look. So now I'm getting it out to do like spraying glazes to layer them. And but I like to find a way that it doesn't, you know. It's like with these decals that people bought at Enseca and everybody's using the same ones on the, you know, and it's kind of, they're nice, but. This is going to be just the very simplest of things that I'm going to do to this one. Okay, so it's on there. It's not on evenly, but we'll pretend it's up. It is. And then, yeah, but I'll tell you, this is what I wanted to do. It's just wipe it out.
Oh, make it blurry.
Just wipe.
This way.
Mm-hmm. I'm just wiping it away. Uh-huh. So now you get the look of it's sort of there, but
it's a ghost.
And depending on what you're putting in it, I don't know, we put this, you could put it all over the whole outside and do this. You know, it's just a soft, nice look. And again, this all depends on what your slip colorant is and what glaze you're putting over it. And you'd be surprised at a lot of the stains and the slips. You have to do some testing, but they even come through some opaque white, you know, glazes. I found that out from my students. That's the best part about teaching, you know, is what they can teach you. Mm-hmm. Was doing the teaching. All right, so I would put this all over this bowl. And that's pretty much it.
Thank you.
Any questions?
What's the tool you use?
I have a carving tool. This one, there's a lot of them. Look at that.